Zyterm, and we're working on the botanical garden. How many of y'all have done any, have seen anything on the botanical garden? Is anybody familiar with the oak? So it's pretty good for miniature. So what I want to talk about today is the native and the bayou gardens. So, you know, there's a lot of vision on this. This has been in the works for 30 years, and the main people involved in this are sort of the philanthropic community. And that's a long list of people. I just want to say, if you know any of these people, or you go to any kind of botanical garden presentation, remember, you know, keep advocating for native plants in some prairie areas. That is something that's in, so any of you, y'all know that the botanical garden is in Glenwood Golf Course, and it's right, it's just within, you know, a mile from the, you know, less than a mile from the Loop 610. And then this is the area here. There's this north part here, and then there's a southern area as well. The north part is the phase one. So this is, next slide. So this is along Sims Bio. The original channel of Sims Bio was here, this sort of circuitous, you know, shape there. And in the 80s, the fork came through and dredged Sims Bio. So this is, it's a secondary channel now. It's not a complete oxbow. It still has some flow through it. So this is the master plan. The central part of the garden is the formal area, and it'll be the formal gardens and the formal use space. And the outside edge is the botanical, is the native and prairie garden area. So this is the area that we're concerned about.
Can you show us that again?
The master plan. So there's the master plan. You can see the central area. Now this is very conceptual. It's very schematic, but. You know, there is sort of formal shape to the inside, to the interior parts of the garden. There is concern that in the community that's involved in this has come forward and said they are interested in showing the ecotypes of Texas. They're interested in trying to show some of the big thicket, trying to show, you know, piney woods, trying to show prairie, trying to show some of the native wetland area. And that would have, that is happening somewhat in some of the interior, but more along the outside edge. The first phase is going to be Wisteria North. It's 120 acres total, and about 90 acres on the island, as we've been calling it. So then the area that we're talking about, you know, in terms of today, would be this sort of area along the edge that's in the first phase, but the budget for this area is not great. It's about $2 million for most of this area along here. The area to the north there is going to be, it's going to be detention pond, because, you know, to offset any movement of soil they have. So that's the area we're talking about. Has anybody been on this side? Okay. So next slide. So most of you know, if you've been on the side, a lot of live oaks, some nice stands of post oak, a lot of cedar elm, some water oak, willow oak, and some really nice red oaks. But also the primary thing, of course, is Bermuda grass, because it's all more than one kind. So again, some rolling areas, you know, in and around the middle, all the, you know, the fairways and whatever. I'm not a golfer, but and you can see at the edge of the golf course is this riparian edge along the bayou, and it's pretty desolate. So we've been tromping about in this. Few weeks ago, we've done a tree survey for the whole area and sort of labeled the trees, you know, not good, dead, damaged, whatever, and trees that will stand in front of the bulldozer for. So we've done those. Mm-hmm. We've done those surveys. Unfortunately, the edge, the dominant species along the edge, is ligustrum. Mm-hmm. And it's just, you know, we really haven't gotten in there and sort of hacked through the bushes. We came out with lots of chiggers. And there's some hackberry. There's some con, a little box elder, but lots and lots and lots of ligustrum. So then the question is, okay, if we take it down, we have to restabilize this slope. And how do you do that whole bio edge when you have a budget of a couple of million? There's some natural, you know, drainage channels through here, but you can see ligustrum. And this is for you, Jaime, because, you know, I think the snakes are an issue because the perception of it, if it's tall, there's going to be snakes. And everybody just wants to kill them, no matter what they are. So we looked at the typology. You know, we've got wetlands, which are maybe a detention pond. We've got some fringe areas along the edge of the bio. We'll have some upland areas. We'll have, you know, hopefully some prairie areas. And then again, sort of that marshy, you know, fringe area. So it's a pretty big, 300 square feet. We figuring how many square foot of seed. Do you remember? Yeah, and this is, it would be an enormous amount of property to try to seed. So you have to say, okay, go to the next slide. So these are our counties. Some of these questions are being thought about. Some of them are in discussion. Some of them are, you know, oh, we're going to have to think about that. The design is being done. The lead design on this is West 8 out of New York, and we're the locals. Okay, so they bring in, you know, again, the West 8's done a lot of work. They did Governor's Island in New York, and they're a very, very, really world-known, renowned designers. We're happy to be involved as the locals. So, you know, how do we create an educational prairie in a high-profile garden? How do you create quality bird habitat out of a pedestrian forest? How do you create a diverse plant palette with limited amount of, you know, seed and plant sources? How do we remove all these infectious species? Do we remove them all? How do you deal with all the Bermuda grass? How do we find and grow out local genotypes on a large scale? How do we involve the local experts? And that's something that they've really got to the point where we say, okay, you're going to do, you know, grass is who do we call here, you're going to do, you know, what kind of gardens are you going to do, and how do you pull those local experts in? They're not quite to that step yet. How do you involve the landscaping garden community? And then again, how do you support the prairie cause? Those are the questions that sort of come to mind, you know, for me, for the garden as a whole, and particularly in this area. So,
perfect.
Okay, so questions, discussion?
Oh, I just want to say I'm so thrilled. I grew up just two blocks from there in the 70s, my age, but I walked many nights in that area when the irrigation would go. And even then in the 70s, it was the late 70s, it was considered old and growing, and we knew it was a natural area, so that's amazing. Thank you.
How many acres is there in natural area, do?
The whole garden, I'm going to flip that to the field. The whole garden's 120 acres. The north part, this area here, is 90 acres. So if that's 90 acres, you know, 30, you know, that's probably about.
And how much money is being spent on the formal garden area? Is it $2 million on the outer?
The primary focus of the garden, you know, the first phase is to get usable space and reuse. And so there'll be a multi-use area, and there'll be, you know, multi-use building. They're going to use this existing garden area as the admin building, as the maintenance over here. So, you know, it's disproportional to the amount of natural area.
Yeah. About how much are they spending?
Just curious.
About 18 to 20 million. Yeah, that's basically. And there's a lot of big picture that, you know, it's going to have to. You know, as designers, everybody kind of gets sort of excited and starts using color pencils, and then you have to get down and use CAD, and it's kind of like, oh, I don't have all of that. So there's some tough decisions, and some of it depends upon, you know, how much money they actually come up with, you know, and whether it's been willing to come up with.
Yeah,
Ben,
are you at all familiar with the Prairie Restoration piece in Millennium Park in downtown Chicago? It's a part of the stuff that was done at the change of the millennium, closest to downtown in that big park that goes all the way down the lake.
And then the Lori Garden, I've walked through that area.
Okay, but it's very interesting the way they've done it. It's all grass prairie, you know, a la Illinois. And it's surrounded by this evergreen hedge of native plants. So unless you kind of know it's there, and you go inside, and they built these big elevated frameworks that are tilted so that when you walk around the low end of it, you're getting a perspective view of the whole thing. And it's very diverse and very contained, but it's something that if you ever get a chance to look at what it's like or go there, it's really amazing what they did. They were right in the heart of the city.
Has there been a bird survey done over there?
Well, I know the Audubon Society has a facility just on the other side of the bayou, so I'm not certain what everything's been surveyed in the area.
There's not great, not great habitat, yeah.
What's your timeframe for?
They want to be under construction by 2018. I think they take it over, they take it over January 2018. They want to be under construction by then.
Part of the other issue is that Botanic Gardens might have a research component associated with it, and that's not just on the formal garden area. So part of the challenge is developing these perimeter pieces so that everything is documented and we know where our seed sources are coming from, and it becomes part of that research component and it can be studied over time. So and it hasn't happened yet, but we're looking for people and interested entities and organizations to step forward and say, hey, we want to be involved. What can we do so that we can start setting that framework up for how to take these parts of the gardens forward?
Is the initial thought to keep some of the topography of the golf course, or will it be graded in any way, or?
There will be some grading, particularly in the central area. There will be some grading.
So most of the site is in the floodplain, a large portion of it. So there will be some adjustment to the grade to ensure that the areas of high impact and where most of the dollars are spent are going to be protected.
Mm-hmm. All right, that was 5 minutes. Now we get to
any comments? Or resolutions?
What is your native plant source going to be primarily? Have you looked at contractors or providers? Or?
The garden will be built by the garden will be built by a contractor, and we have a contract manager already on board. And the drawings will be done, and then we put out to bid in the contracting community. Now, in some cases, I think I'm not supposed to be talking. In some cases, what we do on large projects, if we know it's coming, we know we don't have the plans. We'll go out in advance, might get somebody, Josh Growers out of Georgetown, and say, you know, we can get the owner to contract with the grower to start getting things done. There's the idea of gathering plants for this and having local genotypes is it's mind-boggling, you know.
So since we've already broken the rules, the detention pond, is it going to have like native wetland plants, or is it going to just be one of those ugly?
Oh, no. Okay. The idea is for it to be vegetated. So that to create that sort of marsh and wetland habitat. Yeah, that would be the idea. And that, to me, is where we're going to have the best bird habitat.
But the
Good, those people are getting embarrassed.
So I was interested to hear if anybody else has issues clearing invasives near riparian areas. You know, one thing we try to do is after cutting down a legume or herbicide one, we try to plant something pretty soon thereafter because it creates a gap. You know, sunlight gets through, and then we try to plant something after, but you know, those roots probably aren't going to be, you know, taking hold in the soil for, you know, 2 years. So it's only what other people are doing.
You know, what we do is we'll do a nicking tree and leave the tree standing so that it creates that shade. It creates a little bit of better habitat for those the saplings to take root and survive.
You don't cut it down, you just leave it there.
It depends on the situation.
Yeah.
But you know, it'd be 50-50 or 60-40 or whatever, but yeah, but we'll definitely do the canopy sand because that raw exposure, not only to the roots in the soil, but also to the saplings themselves, right, to get them to survive. Yeah. Especially if there's
other species inside,
is it pretty much anything and everything, but we won't use anything. Whether the location, the client, and the conditions, so many variables.
Mike Lang, the geostation ball right now, the test of public lands, he's always talked about his work in the home. He's always talked about his experience and his experience in the last 3 years. Is that a lot of times you go in and you try to get rid of those first succession things. This is what he's experienced. new areas you're protecting, it's in the part of the willow trees, and if you just give it time, then those seedlings, those tree seedlings are growing up on the new berry, and they're keeping them collected, and eventually those trees will allow the new berries in those first succession plants, and then they go away into the shade. So I think, I don't know if that's appropriate for the prairie or whatever, but this idea of slowing down and seeing, not being so quick to just eradicate everything.
You know, one thing that is appropriate kind of prairie in this situation is that when you do clear all riparian areas, you can create canopy gaps, and those canopy gaps they fill in with pioneer species that oftentimes are a lot of different herbaceous prairie plants. Like dewberry, for instance.
I think one thing I'd like to mention is that getting the story of prairies right is very difficult, and it's very key for the general public. So certainly we'll be, you know, I can say for CPP and for KPC, we'll be very excited to work alongside you guys to develop a good narrative for it, because it goes to the very heart of what Texas is all about, and it's a very powerful story, but it's not been daylighted for people. So once it gets daylighted, people don't want to touch it. They think it's an amenity instead of a snake magnet.
Yeah.
All right, 5 minutes.
All right.